Participants can post your queries in the chat box. Selected queries will be answered by the resource person. The feedback form will be shared in the chat box towards the end of the session. Remember to maintain online etiquette throughout the session. Without anything further to do, let's start our program by invoking the presence of Almighty. For this, I would like to invite Ms. Shreeba Mumtaz of 3rd BSc Psychology.
Jaya Jagadisha, Jaya Sagadisha, Jagadurga Deva, Sakalavni Sharanavni Sayujimni Arivin Arivin Ni Swayam Yandar Amrita Varshini Yaku Niravin Niravin Yandari Smihatkin Kadiruli Yachuri Shandi Dan Naru Nirava Puriyu Jaya Jagadisha Jaya Sakalisha Jagadur Dharak Deva Sakala Bhumi Sharana Bhumi Sayujimni Sayujimni Sayujimni.
Thank you, Shreeba. Now, I would like to invite our speaker, Ms. Adira PV, to welcome the gathering.
Thank you, Nikita. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
It makes a big difference in your life when you stay positive. Good evening to all the dignitaries, colleagues, and my dear students. We know the pandemic. Our stay connected. But a few people suffer mentally also. A sound mind in a sound body, physical and mental health paves way for a better life. Today, we are going to take part in an international webinar on. It gives me tremendous contentment to be presenting the welcome speech amongst the most extreme personality. It's my privilege to welcome today's guest, Dr. Ashok Kumar Sahay, Professor and Ex-Chairman, Department of Psychology, Jagannath University, Bangladesh. In spite of his busy schedule, he has wholeheartedly agreed to be a part of this webinar. He has extensive experience in organizational behavior, and he has authored several books in the same. So, we are indeed blessed to have the right person for the session. On behalf of Psychology Department, I welcome you, sir. Next, let me welcome the person who always standing with us, the energy behind UX Kshetra College, Reverend Father Shaiju Periyar, Assistant Director of UX Kshetra College, for delivering his valuable message. I welcome you, Father.
Thank you.
With immense pleasure, let me welcome our backbone of department, very dignified personality, Mr. Jit George, Head of Department Psychology. I welcome you, sir. Next, let me utilize this opportunity to welcome the brain behind the program, our program coordinator, Mr. Sanath Thomas, Assistant Professor, Department of Psychology. to this event. I welcome you, sir. Now I welcome the student coordinator, Ms. Anjali Ravikumar, third year psychology. Now, last but not the least, let me welcome all my students and participants for today's program. I'm sure that we all are going to have a great time today. Once again, let me welcome all of you to this program. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for your earnest welcome. Next, we have a message from our Assistant Director, Reverend Father Shaiju Parekar.
Thank you, Nikita, for welcoming me. A very good evening to everyone. I am very grateful and privileged for being part of this international webinar. At the very outset, I would like to appreciate and congratulate the Department of Psychology, Yogyakshetra College, for choosing this topic for this international webinar, New Trends in Organizational Behavior. Though this topic has been studied for decades, it has not lost its relevance. Because whatever we do in our life, that is for being more effective, productive, and successful. As we all know, organization behavior is the study of how people behave in organizational settings. So when we know the behavior of people, we can explain, predict, and influence the behavior of the people, which would help us in return to run an institution, an organization, a system more effectively. And there are many factors that would influence the behavior of the people. And I'm sure this international webinar today would throw some light on all these aspects. My best wishes to Dr. Ashok Kumar Saha, today's resource person, the Department of Psychology, and to all the participants of this webinar. I officially declare as this international webinar open. Thank you, and once again wish you all the very best.
Thank you, Father, for your precious thoughts. Now, I would like to invite Ms. Nimisha K. of 3rd BSc Psychology to introduce the resource person.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm immensely honored to introduce you to today's resource person, Dr. Ashok Kumar Saha, Professor, Department of Psychology, Jagannath University. He is also working as a professor of the Jagannath University. He has been implementing a project titled Advanced Teaching Learning in Psychology and HEQEP Supplementary Project as a sub-project manager of HEQEP UGC World Bank. He did his BSc in 1987 and MSc in 1988 from Department of Psychology at Rajshahi University. He was awarded DPhil in Psychology from Allahabad University in 2002. He had received the centrally awarded doctoral fellowship by ICSSR, Ministry of HRD, Government of India. Dr. Saha is internationally known accomplished teacher, researcher, educationist, and a development worker in the area of psychology, management, and development issues. He has contributed in different national and international journals. He has 3 books of his authorship titled including Group Decision Making, Social Psychology, and Human Resource Management. He has published several chapters in major volumes, including a chapter in the book titled Merging Past, Present, and Future. He has presented 27 research papers in national and international conferences. Dr. Saha has received 18 research papers so far from different organizations, that is, World Bank, HEQEP, MOST, Ministry of Education, UGC, SSRC, and ICSSR, etc. He has started his career with Bangladesh Rural Advancement Committee in 1993. Dr. Saha has multidisciplinary experience working with partner organizations of the World Bank, WFP, WHO, ActionAid, etc. He has also worked for disaster management with several donors organizations in the country and abroad. Dr. Saha was the editor-in-chief, Jagannath University Journal of Psychology, 2015 to 2018, which is a peer-reviewed journal. We are really fortunate to have such a sensational personality to flag off our international webinar on new trends in organizational behavior. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Nimisha. We indeed feel very lucky to have your presence today, sir. I kindly invite you to begin the session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. Let me welcome all of you in this international webinar on organizational behavior. Thank you, the organizer of this webinar, and you have already introduced myself. And I frequently visit India, and I have done my PhD from Allahabad University under Indian Council of Social Science Research. And since then, I am working in Bangladesh, and right now, I am the professor and ex-chairman of the department. I also act as an assistant proctor and proctor of this university for several years. And I am also associated with some private universities in Bangladesh as an adjunct faculty member to teach organizational behavior and introduction to psychology. So before I introduce and I introduce organizational behavior as a whole in my discussion, so I want to give some of the definition which is very important to understand organizational behavior. Organizational behavior can be defined as the understanding, prediction, and management of human behavior of the employee in an organization. Actually, it is very important to understand human behavior, because if we need to predict human behavior, and then you must to know also how to manage the human behavior in the organization. We need to understand and prediction, because once you are interested to appoint someone in your organization, you have to have predict the behavior, because we as an employer or as a manager of the human resource development, I do not want that someone whom I appoint today will not able to disturb in future, or will not able to do something which is against the organization. So these are the two authors, Fred Luthans and Newstrom Cape Davies, are very familiar, popular, and all of you know that they have their volumes of understanding on organizational behavior. Organizational behavior is the study and application of knowledge about how people as an individual or as group act within the organization. This is also very much important nowadays, because as an individual human being, as an individual employee, the way we behave with the management, and whenever I act as a group or I represent a group, I act with the management is a different way, because there is some pressure of group so that I may act with the management people differently. So it is also very much important to understand this organizational behavior in this way.
Please share the screen.
I have some difficult feelings, some difficulties.
No, somebody tampered in, but kindly manage.
Okay, I will use my mouse. Okay. So what do we study organizational behavior? As I told you, which is very important subject in the area of business, particularly for productivity and to handle with the human being or employee in the organization, because we need to ensure that our business operate more effectively. If you know the organizational behavior, if you know the if you understand the employees' behavior and their future outcomes, then it will be very easy to handle them and to operate them smoothly and for effectively in a business organization. The study of organizational behavior gives insight on how employees behave and perform in the workplace. That means we need to know the way they actually used to work in an organization and the workplace, because workplace environment is a very difficult environment, because there might be possibility that peoples around the world, people around the different culture used to work together. So it is a very challenging place. Actually, we need to understand this workplace environment. It helps us to develop an understanding of the aspects that can motivate employees, increase their performance, and help organization, because we are actually interested for better performance of the employee. If we need to see the better performance of the employee, we also need to see whether they are motivated properly or not. If they have proper motivation, if they have intrinsic motivation, if they have extrinsic motivation, then definitely what we expect as an employer, we can achieve the organizational objective with proper utilization of the human resources in the organization. So that is the very useful in the importance of organizational behavior. There are several trends I have found in different books and different practitioners. So I will definitely discuss some of the trends which are old, some are moderate, some are very new. So we'll discuss the new trends afterwards, but these are also one kind of understanding of the trends. Ethical challenges. Nowadays, you see, the organizations are very much ethical in their practices, but some of the organizations earlier, they are really unethical in practicing different rules and regulations in the organization. And because of this globalization, there is a rapid technological changes is taking place in the in all over the world with the different type of organization, and a flattening world as well. And sustainable business practice is also one of the major issues that as a businessman or the owner of the business, they want to see that organization must be sustainable, because when I think for sustainability, we think for the profitability, we think for productivity, we think for making profit out of my investment. So sustainable, without sustainability, actually no organization can live for a long time. And there is a demographic trends also. People around the world are supposed to work in different organizations, and a global marketplace also, because if you go to Dubai, in Singapore, or any other country, you will find people from around the world are coming to that place to work in the same organization. So these trends will influence the way work gets done today and in the future. That means this is not only influence in our future work, but also influence our present time in the organization. So several emerging trends are impacting our organizational life, like globalization, diversity, flexibility, flat, and networks. As you know, that because of the development of industrialization and development of globalization, different organizations are emerging and are competing with the other organization globally. Sometimes maybe organization is located in a very peripheral and local area, but nowadays they are very much familiar with the global organization, because the product is available in the rural area, is also available in the remote area. and also available in the capital city, anywhere in the country and anywhere in the world. So people are competing with this globalization, and also they are competing because of their sustainability and diversity. Diversity is also in different kinds and different types. Diversity in language, diversity in economic investment, diversity in politics, diversity in different way is also impacting in our organizational life. And flexibility, you know that flexibility is very important, because in traditional point of view, people are not very that much flexible. They are very much strict about implementing the rules of the organization in the traditional point of view. But nowadays, people are very much flexible because they are very much supporting to the employee so that they can work properly for the betterment of the organization as well as for the betterment of the society. Plots and networks. Networks, you see the networking because of this current world, we are also involved with this network. The organization is supposed to maintain network with different organization and peoples also as an individual, as an employee, you also maintain network with other people for the sake of the development of the organization and for the sake of the development of our personal career also. These five emerging trends creates tension for organizational leaders and employees as they go through waves of changes in their organization. Because once you are thinking these things, the trends, then you must have thinking that how it is also, there are a lot of challenges involved with these trends. And employees are also involved with, is a part of these stakeholders. So they are also thinking to bringing changes in the organization. And they are always thinking that how we can bring some changes in the organization. Because the world is changing. The economy is changing. The politics, local politics is changing. So changes is almost inevitable from the very beginning. So if we do not know how to adapt to this changing scenario, it will be very difficult for us to sustain as an organizational leader, as a businessman, as the owner of the organization. So globalization is the foremost important things in studying organizational behavior, as globalization can help in studying the nature of groups and individuals associated with the group. This can further be arranged in a disciplinary mode to enhance the existing behavior. Technological changes. Technological changes is very important because you know, every time there is a new technology is coming in the market, and that is very competitive, because without sophisticated and updated technology, it is very difficult to compete with the products available in the market. So you have to establish new technology for your organization. But advancement of technology is not that much easy to bring in the organization without talking with the employee, existing employee, because many employees, they don't want to bring in some changes from within. So there must be some meeting we can conduct with them to greet the session.
Hi, sir. Hello. Could you please present it once more?
Hello.
Hello, sir. Yes, could you present the slide one more time?
Yes, I think I will finish, able to finish in 45 to 1 hour. No problem.
Yeah, sir. Could you just start from first, because many of the participants are not able to follow.
Is this visible? My slides are visible?
Yes, sir, it's visible now. And participants, kindly do not share your screens. We share, do not do Ashok sir's slides. Sir, you may begin now. It's visible.
Is it visible now?
Yeah, it's visible.
Are there any problem with these slides?
No, not now. Now it's okay, sir.
Okay then. So changing workforce is also a major one kind of present trends and very challenging itself. The changing workforce is impacting employees' retention, because nowadays, you know, the retention and rejection of the employee or termination as an employee is a very difficult and challenging problem for us. So unless you can retain your employee, I mean efficient employee, skilled employee, or experienced employee, that you will be in loser. So nowadays, as we are very much concerned about the salary and benefits and other comfort for the employee, because we are very much concerned for the candidate's reputation during our hiring the employees. When we used to recruit people, we used to know their expectation and their interest and their capacities and their skills and their experiences. So considering all these things, our salary and compensation package is also very good. We are offering good salary all over the world. And also, we are very much concerned because of their retention. I hope that the salary and benefit we are providing for the employee, so that they will not reject the job, they will not resign from the job. So this is one of the major shift of all employees and employers should be aware in the rapidly evolving new world. So this is very important things in the changing workforce. Yes, there is a new volume as published on trends in organizational behavior, employees versus owners issues. Carrie L. Cooper, who is a professor of organizational psychology and mental health, and also a vice chancellor of Lancaster University, who has published almost 100 books and 400 scholarly articles for academic journals, and is a frequently contributors of national newspaper, TV, and radio as well. And he is also editor-in-chief of the International Journal of Stress and Health and president of British Association of Counseling and Psychotherapy. And his co-author, Professor Dennis, is also Carnegie Mellon University of USA. And this gist of this book, I have tried to outline how to keep update with the current development and issues in the study and practice of organizational behavior. That means it is also very important and necessary to update with the information and knowledge about the organizational behavior. Unless you update your knowledge, it will be very difficult to challenge the new problems arises in the organization. This is the challenge for students, academics, and practitioners as well. This series of complements the standard test of organizational behavior and more comprehensive historical reviews volumes by offering concise, critical, and stimulating accounts of the main issues and development in topics of current and ongoing importance in organizational behavior. Where employees should be stakeholders in their business and relationship between employees and owners and in general. That means here you see the relationship between the owner and the employees are very important. We nowadays emphasizing on these issues because unless a good and comfortable and congenial atmosphere established between the employee and employer, organization is not possible for the organization to develop and to make profit out of their service. So this is very, very important issues. So topic discussed in this volume is employee equity. You see, equity, what does it mean? Equity and equality is not the same thing here. Employee equity means you have to, as a manager or as a owner or as an employer, you have to give priority those who are very efficient, those who are very skilled, those who are intelligent, those who are experienced. So give them priority based on their capacity, ability, and intelligence and merit. So give, and also based on the contribution. If some employee have contributed more, you should give them more opportunity, more promotion, more facilities for those employees. Those employees are less productive, less efficient, so give them less. So that is the very important issues nowadays. Our practitioners are very comfortably practicing these issues. Share ownership of workers. Ownership of workers is very important. As an employee, if we do not feel a positive identity with the organization, then it is very difficult for me to work for the organization. I should feel that this is my organization. I am the part of this organization. I am the one of the major stakeholders of this organization. So I am associated with this organization. I belong to this organization, so that there is ownership will be developed. And ownership will also develop if you can provide some opportunities. You can also share some profit among the employees. So that is another way of sharing the ownership of the workers. So in different way, we can share our ownership of the organization. Ownership and changing employment relationship. And as I told you, the relationship what we had earlier, nowadays we are shifting from that traditional point of view to globalized point of view. Because we are now not very much strict, rather we are always emphasizing for good relationship. Nowadays, you see, we are always developing new technologies, new methodologies, new events, new cultural programs, new recreational programs with the employees. Get together. Every time we want to see that management are offering get together, offering some program with all the employees are participating there. And there is a lot of opportunity to mix up with the other family members as well and to take care of them. And we are very much concerned, not only we are concerned for your good salary, but we are concerned for the welfare of these employees and the betterment of the employees and the welfare, not only welfare of the employees, but the welfare of the dependent of the employees. That is also our concern. We are also concerned as an employer to see the betterment of the child's and their family members and their recreational activities or their other and any other things. Employee loyalty is very important. Unless an employee is loyal to the organization, it will be very difficult to achieve the organizational objectives. So be loyal. So the loyalty is a kind of practice an employer can do it from the very beginning, so that employee will be always loyal to the employer. And if they are very much loyal, then it is very easy to utilize themselves in a better way. Whatever you will order, whatever you will command, whatever you will just give a provision, and they will definitely do it without asking any questions. So that is also very important issues are discussed in this model. Achieving ownership of the performance. That means you have to recognize the performance of the employee in different way. Maybe you can give rewards, you can recognize them in a meeting, or you can give a momentum, or you can give some extra benefit, or you can give any type of praise or any type of praise also. You can praise them so that they will feel they are the owner, they have some kind of ownership with this organization. Open book management. You see, open book. Open book can read it, anyone can read it. So it is a kind of things which is not hide and secret. Every practice in the organization that must be open for everyone. So everyone is supposed to know what is happening everywhere in the management. That is the very important things I consider also that is emphasize them in this book. Employee stock transfer in essence. Employees have their prominent firm, have their benefits, and organization should transfer this all these for income generation for their benefit purpose, so that employee will be benefited in future with their prominent firm or with their savings. So for a quick, insightful, and authoritative windows on the latest in OBE, scholars and professionals will continue to turn on the woolly series of trends in organizational behavior. So these are the topic have been widely discussed as a trends in organizational behavior in terms of the employee and employer. So I think it is an important volume which is published recently by Willy Series. And there is another way of understanding I have seen in another books. They have also discussed the practitioners and as well as the academicians are also is not differ in the practice of organizational behavior. Organizational behavioral practice in management or by the HR personnel and in the academicians, they have no different attitudes in practicing and learning organizational behavior. So organizations have witnessed a great development from the olden time, in particularly in respect of structure, operation, and people. There is a considerable changes in the cross-cultural environment, influence of MNCs, growth in the technical know-how and quality management. And you see, these are the things are proposed here as a new trends in organizational behavior. Globalization, emerging employee relationship. Globalization, as you know, and I have already explained, emerging employment relationship. Relationship, what is emphasizing nowadays, it was not practiced earlier. So nowadays, we are supporting employees all the time in different way to ensure a good relationship, to maintain and establish a good relationship in the organization. We as an employer, we also, and practitioner, they used to create a certain environment in the organization so that everyone will be very feel comfortable to work with this environment. And definitely, they will maintain the relationship with the other people in the organization. And that is an asset for the organization nowadays, I can tell you, because unless the relationship you will not fail to develop with the organization, it will be very difficult to employ. So this way, I think it is a very emphasizing point I also. And changing workforce, I also discussed knowledge management, information and technology, and OB, I will discuss later. Emerging employment relationship to better plan and response to change in the workplace and showing changes in the modern era. No more autocratic and participatory style of leadership is welcome nowadays. As I told you, and there was a tendency in the management to exercise power with the employee. So that situation is over. Nowadays is no more, but still, organization like South Asian countries, as I experienced, because I had my different type of other job in earlier, I associated with the private organization, and I saw that many CEOs or the senior executives of the organization used to misbehave with the subordinates or supervisors when the targeted achievement does not achieve. They are become very much aggressive. So this type of aggressiveness is become very reducing nowadays, and still it is totally absent in the Western pattern. So flexible working hours is also earlier it was not. There is a strict time maintenance, but nowadays you are flexible to how much time you will work, when you will work, and how your employees are motivated to perform in their best. It is from within, from the employee. Unless the employee is motivated, they will not work spontaneously. You cannot abuse them. You cannot drive them properly unless they are not extrinsically motivated, and they will not work spontaneously for the organization, for the management. Management now welcome upward communication rather than only participation in the lower level employees. You know, there are two types of communication communication mechanism in the organization. One is upward communication, one is bottom-up communication. Bottom-up communication is the grassroots level people or the supervisory level people or the workers level people will suggest for the organization what they should do. Because they are the stakeholders, they know it better than they know. Particularly in the development organization, people used to practice this session. And not in the corporate sector, but in the corporate sector, people used to the communication system is from bottom up to bottom. Up to bottom means from upside to bottom side. So this is the two way of communication practiced in different organizations. And changing workforce, I have already discussed, but here I want to say something that to take our less skilled workforce initially and develop them rather than simply hiring the experienced people. Actually, if you see, we are now changing workforce because we are now giving importance of the HR system. As long as we are giving the importance of the HR system, we are emphasizing their capacities. We believe in their capacities. We believe in their attitudes. We believe in their needs. We believe in their training. We believe in their adaptation with the changing workforce. So I must bring some changes among the employees in terms of skills. And we are updating their skills. We are updating their manner. We are updating their merit, we are updating their skills for a particular job. Because once you are employed as a manager, HR manager, it is my duty to enhance this kind of capacities of the workforce so that they will be able to work better, they will be motivated better, so that will be ultimately is better for the organization to achieve the organizational objective. So this is also very challenging and one of the new trend in organizational behavior. And now you see knowledge management. Knowledge management is also, it is very, I think it is almost 30 years old concept, 35 years old concept, but now it is become very, very important concept in HR management, particularly organizational behavior. Because all the organization's capacity or the employee's capacity to acquire, share, and utilize knowledge for the survival and success. If you need to survive, if you, for long-term survival of the management, you need to use knowledge bank. You need to use your knowledge in a capacity, in different capacity to acquire and share and utilize knowledge for its survival and success. And knowledge management of organizational culture is very important, and it is the central knowledge creation, sharing, and uses. Relationship between individual and organizational knowledge is very important nowadays. And third is social interaction that determines how knowledge will be used in particular situation. If you have many knowledge, you have latest knowledge, you have updated knowledge, you have to know which knowledge is very important to solve any particular problem of the management. So this knowledge mapping is also very important. Knowledge mapping is very important. And so that you can use this knowledge to solve that problem immediately where it happens. And knowledge is created, you know, any type of organization for the survival and for the development, it is very important. It is very important to create knowledge or innovation. Without innovation, innovative knowledge or a creative knowledge, your organization will not survive for the long run. Because to compete with other organization, you have to be very creative. Your employee must be creative, but all employees are not creative. Only few people are very creative in one organization. but you have to nurture them, because they are very much indisciplined. They are very much, they don't care about the management. But you have to, as a manager or as a senior person with the management, you have to know who is the creative person, who is the creative employee in your organization. You have to nurture them, because if you can properly nurture them, they will create something, they will give you idea, they will give you a lot of newest thing. That is very important to compete with the other organization, to develop your product and to develop your product so that it will sell for the future. And it should be legitimate as well as is distributed in the organization. Anything, it should be legitimate. Illegitimate things will not be surviving any organization. Illegal things will not welcome by any organization. So it should be legitimate. It should not be contradictory with the existing law of the country. Whatever you create, whatever the ideology, whatever the discipline, whatever the existing things you have, that should not be contradictory with the existing law and rules of the country. Country, it must be comparable with those existing law and the existing rules of the country. There are four basic elements of knowledge management. Knowledge acquisition is very important, and it is through experience, sensation, and perception we can we can gather knowledge. So knowledge is very important. So you can maintain a knowledge bank in your organization, and you can also have to have some kind of permission to share your knowledge among the family members, friends, and community, as well as in the work with the employees. Knowledge dissemination, that means you have to disseminate your knowledge. Unless you disseminate your knowledge, how the other people will practice it, how the other people will know it. So it is better to organize certain program time to time to disseminate the knowledge. You know, like a researcher is always try to find out some of the conferences where he can disseminate his own idea in front of the other scholars, and so that there might be a good some feedback, so he can update their knowledge in the research experience as well. So that is the only way to develop our knowledge, to reach our knowledge. So increase awareness and ability to make an informed choice on available alternatives are the outcomes of the knowledge dissemination. If you have different type of knowledge, then you have different options. You can choose which one is appropriate to solve a particular problem. Knowledge mapping. Knowledge map is a guide for the employee to understand what knowledge is needed to increase their efficiency and productivity. That means I have to know which knowledge is important for this particular task, which knowledge is important to solve this particular problem. And this is knowledge map, and where the knowledge are located. I know my knowledge is there, but I don't know how to use it. So that nowadays, you see, in different subjects, once we are talking about the quality education, that means we need to know that after the education will finish, how far this student will be able to use in practice, in management, in business, or in psychology, or in any other discipline. We not only want to teach students, we want to see how far they will be able to relate this knowledge in practical problem. How they can solve the practical problem when they will work as a professional. So as a professional, you have to have ability to solve all those problems. Information technology and organizational behavior. Technological changes and enhancement is a very important and most salient factors impacting organizations and employees too. So you need to implement new technologies. Technology has changed the nature of the work as well as the role of employees. And normal tendency of the employees is that they don't want to bring any changes in the organization because of their traditional viewpoint. Because they think if I take this, if I accept the changes, then I might lose my job or I'll be in difficulties. So they have their working employees union, so they may go against you. So it is better to talk with them, give them concept, and what will be the ultimate outcomes of this technological change, you can explain in front of them. And also you can ask their opinion. I think the most of them will give their normal opinion, which is favorable. But of course, there might be some of the people though, who will not agree with them. They will differ in their viewpoint. So if they differ in their viewpoint, you can use some brief session to manage them in different way. You can also use different type of group pressure to manage them so that they will agree finally to bring some changes in the organization, because changes in the organization will give some kind of sophisticated product, and you will some more productivity will be very high, you will earn a lot of money, and that will definitely take part in the development of the organization. And if your organization is become profitable, you can share your profit, some of the percentage among the employees of your organization, and you can share on the basis of different way. So frequent sessions on change management can help employees to understand, use, and adopt new technologies easily. I think this is very, very challenging issues nowadays to bring any technological change in the organization. But if you can think overnight, it is not possible. You have to think evolutionary way, not revolutionary way. Revolutionary way is it will be not, it will, you will definitely, you will be failure to bring some changes. But if you take this decision long before, discuss with them in different way, different forum, and just convey them what will be the ultimate outcomes of the changes. If you can name them, then they will be definitely, the organization will be benefited, and they will agree with such changes, because they will think there is no way we will lose our job. Rather, there is a possibility that we will gain because of profit sharing in the annual general meeting. So this is a very good way. What are the other emergent trends in organizational behavior? Business environments are dynamic and which changes frequently, and it is expected to continually update their understanding of organizational behavior. As I told you, that you have to update all the organizational behavior that is taking place and coming from the academician and practitioner. System approach. System approach is a very important issue, as you understand that organizations are built as complex open system interacting with various elements to achieve the desired goal. And it is very important because it is an external internal factors. We are sometimes depend with those external and internal factors to maintain the system approach. The system aspect of organizational behavior provides synergetic effects. But that means it will maintain a synergy among the employer and in the system. So it is also the challenging approach. Contingency variable. Contingency variable is an approach in the organizational behavior or management, so that you can address any problem arises in a particular position, particular situation. You should address them, talk to them, and you can solve that problem immediately as a contingency basis. Sometimes we think contingency approach may not good. Better it should consider as a whole system approach. I mean, it is not only problem of with the marketing or with the finance or with the HR department or admin department. We should consider it is a problem of the organization. There is no more one best way to solve the behavioral aspect of an organization. There is not only one way. So you may have some other way to solve organizational problems. That is the whole system approach. Human orientation. Nowadays, you know that we are emphasizing on human orientation rather than the only autocratic system. Organizational behavior has supported and practiced human orientation. We are not only giving good salary to the employee, but also we are very much concerned for their welfare and their recreational activities, their betterment and their future security, job security, and creativity and skill they have. If they have, we should nurture them. We should always engage the employee to enhance their skills for the growth and the development of the organization and for the growth and development of the employees also. So management is now become very active and supported to the employees because this will bring some positive attitudes towards employees are encouraged. Because you know, when we used to work in any organization, if we do not have attitude, positive attitude, I may have good intelligence, but I should have positive attitudes towards the organizational point of view, to the views of the organizational objectives, to views of the organizational goals. So that is very important. Then you do not need to tell me all the time, you do this, you do that, you don't need to. Because if I am motivated from the within, I will work for the organization. So nowadays, human orientation and our betterment and welfare is very much emphasized. And distribution of power, as I told you that nowadays the organization is not practicing that autocratic model anymore. Rather, we are distributing the power to the every officers in based on their position, based on their level, based on their designation. So it should be distributed. It is not only used by the senior management, not only used by the chairman, not only used by the MD, not only used by the director, but also manager can use some kind of power. And it should be based on their level, based on their position, power should be distributed so that there will be no misunderstanding about the role play, about the role play. So no way there will be some difficulties. So these are the way we can practice. So the decentralization and distribution of power is provided opportunity for employees to manage their work and enhance organizational effectiveness. So actually our intention is to see the effectiveness of the organization. And this way we find our distribution of proper distribution of power, it is the better way to achieve the organizational objectives rather than using autocratic way of distribution of power. So I think this is one of the major aspects. I have two more slides to discuss with you. So I think self-discipline again is very important. Every time organization will tell me, do this, maintain this discipline. It should not be like this. Discipline is something, it should be obligation type. Because I know the rules, I should follow the rules. I should know the procedure, I should maintain the discipline. So it is sometimes from the within. I should practice without any compulsion, without any pressure, without any... It is something which is spontaneously coming from my mindset. So it is not that every time my boss will tell me, you are late today. I will not do late because I know the time of the office time. So I will not do late any day in my office. So it is from the within. It is based on my motivation and my self-discipline, how I can maintain my discipline of my own. That is very important. And this is very useful. To set rules and acceptable behavior standards That means what is the standard behavior? You know, standard behavior is the kind of norm. What I have to do in my society, it is prescribed by the society. It is not myself. I learn how to move around in my society, how to maintain law and order and discipline in my society, because I have learned it from very beginning, because society governed by that norm, social norm, and it is a standard type of behavior. So I should follow that standard behavior and norms of the organization as well. The rules and regulation practiced in one organization, and behavior is behavioral regularities practiced in one organization, it is like a standard form of practice. So I should know that standard form, and I should practice in that way without any compulsion, without any pressure, without any order. I mean, I can do this automatically. So these are the self-discipline is a very important traits in organizational behavior. I think one more slide I need to discuss that intrinsic motivation. Intrinsic motivation is one of the major trend in organizational behavior. Motivation is concerned with stimulating the energies and employees to achieve the desired result. That means, what are the desired result of the organization? So as an employee, whether I am working on the same way or not, that is a very important issue. So I think this is a very important issue, and if I am intrinsically motivated, so you do not tell me all the time to do this. And so it is very, very important issue nowadays to maintain or enhance intrinsic relationship of the employer. So thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to present and to discuss as a resource person of new trend in organizational behavior for it. And thank you the participants, and thank you the organizer of this event. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for the informative session. Now we will begin our doubt clearing session. Selected questions will be answered by the resource person. Sir, may I read out the questions? Okay, the first question, what is organizational design?
Organizational design, you know, you have, I'm not discussed, although I am not discussed here, organizational design. Organizational design is, you see, there's an organogram. Are you saying about the organogram? If you are talking about the organogram, then you must know it. Organogram is just like a tree of the framework of the organization for different type of position, who will be the work over there, and what are the assigned tasks for the every peoples are already been written and understood by all the employees. Are you saying about this organogram or organizational design? Is it? Please.
Sir, I guess it's organizational design.
Organizational design is not actually discussed in anywhere in organizational behavior, but we have only discussed, or we can read, the organizational organogram. Organogram is a kind of a framework to understand the framework.
I think due to some technical issue, Mr. Ashok has left the meeting. Please be there. He is joining in a minute.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You are audible.
Yes. 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 The problem with my other device. Hello.
Yes, sir. You are audible. You can continue, sir.
No, no. Are there any other question? Waiting for question. Other question.
Yes, sir. The next question.
Yes.
Yes, sir. There's one more question. With work from home becoming popular these days, how do you think this new trend affects employees' relationship? And how do you think, as aspiring psychologists, should we prepare ourselves?
Well, thank you. It's a very good question. Actually, nowadays, all the organizations are thinking about the relationship and behavioral aspect with other people. And so that, I think we are nowadays, our graduates are preparing themselves to solve many behavioral problems organization, particularly in HR as well as training and also in the admin level also they are doing very well, particularly those who are doing graduation in industrial and organizational psychology, and that post-graduation is organizational psychology. They are doing well and they are getting good training because like other countries, developing countries, our countries and this Indian subcontinent's organizations have become very developed and practicing international standard of managerial systems. So people are thinking nowadays, and also because of their changing scenario, they are appointing industrial psychologists, and they are taking this challenge in several organizations and doing well. And some of the psychologists are also working in a freelance system. I mean, they are working as a consultant and as a recruitment agencies. In Bangladesh, there are some recruitment agencies are working in which psychologists are working over there, and they're doing very well. It is a very current trend in organizational and industrial psychology in Bangladesh. So I think our graduates, those who are getting training, receiving training right now, in future they will be able to do it after the completion of academic degree. They will able to get chance to use their knowledge and to face the challenges in organizational behavior in the industry and different organizations.
Thank you, lot, sir, for clearing all our doubts. It's time to wind up our program. I would like to invite the student coordinator, Ms. Anjali Ravi Kumar of 3rd BSc Psychology, for the vote of thanks.
Good evening, everyone. On behalf of the Department of Psychology, I consider it a great privilege to propose the vote of thanks to those who have directly or indirectly contributed to this workshop. Firstly, I would like to thank my resource person, Dr. Ashok Kumar, for this informative and interesting session. On behalf of our colleagues in the department, we thank you for spending your valuable time with us. Thank you, sir. Next, I would like to thank our assistant program coordinator, Ms. Adira PV, for the formal welcome address. I also express my sincere gratitude. I would like to thank our management, program coordinator, Mr. Sanu Thomas, and assistant program coordinator, Ms. Adira PV, for their infinite dedication and guidance in making this event possible. Last but not the least, I take this opportunity to thank all our participants for their active participation and cooperation. Thank you all, and I hope you have a great week. Thank you.
Thank you, Anjali. With the hope that everyone has benefited through this session, it's time to wrap up. The feedback form will be provided in the chat box. Kindly fill it carefully before you leave. The certificates will be generated as soon as you fill in the feedback form. Thank you all again. Have a nice day.
Once again, thank you so much, sir, for joining with
thank
us.
You. Thank you. Thank you. You're welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.